I'm pleased to be here, and you've heard an awful lot today from the speakers before me, and a lot of it's been very, I guess, construction focused, what's happening when, what those curves are, and what's happening. And I want to have just kind of a slight change of pace initially. Because the story, whilst the construction story is the story of now, and it's very exciting and also slightly frightening with some of those numbers and the challenges it gives all of us, we don't want to lose sight of why all that's happening and why it's so important. And really what the goal is to really try and make sure that we've got a growing, vital, exciting place to live where people have got great jobs and people can do business well. And this construction is part of, we need that, and we can also grow off the back of it. But it's not neutral. So if we look at this work here, and this is work that was actually led by CDC and with a whole lot of others that built into this what the scenario might be. And so if you look at this black line here, which really shows what was our trajectory before we had the earthquakes and what was going on in terms of growth in Canterbury. And it says estimate just because it's actually quite hard to disaggregate and get GDP and growth like, just for a region within inside. But and then there's these variety of alternative kind of outcomes and trajectories that we might get to. And so what you'll notice is actually the start of those trajectories here following an earthquake is they're all quite similar. And so there's the risk that actually you don't quite know which one you're going to get to if you're not really attending to things in here. But certainly if you look at the red one, which is actually a declining economy, so if we don't get this right, if we don't all do our part, it will actually look all right for a while, and then there will be actually quite a steep and quite sustained decline. And so really what we're trying to do is get in here. Now, what that will take is actually to make sure that we're getting productive growth underneath and because of the construction boom. Because the construction boom gets us our buildings, gets us our roads, does those things, but it's actually what happens inside those that delivers the growth and the productivity. And so I guess our team and many of you are as focused on that growth and productivity. The construction helps us get there. And there are just multiples, these are a couple of examples, but there's multiples of goals that we need to hit to absolutely make sure that we're in here and that people can stay on after the boom of construction and that this is a great place to live and do business. It's also useful, I think, to remind ourselves about where were we just after the earthquakes. And just after the earthquakes, a really sensible thing to do is to go around the world and talk to the kind of biggest brains out there about recovery from a big natural disaster. Well, it seemed like a good idea until we had to listen to what they told us. And this was what they told us we could expect and that this would be what we would be dealing with. Certainly rapid depopulation, but even worse there would be an ongoing decline. Capital flight, the risks and the uncertainties would just be so high that it would be incredibly difficult for the private sector. That there would be huge and rapid unemployment growth. And remember, that wasn't surprising because we did actually have to tell them that 50,000 people had lost their workplaces in one afternoon. Certainly, wholesale business closure, slow growth and a decline. And probably the worst one, they said actually earthquakes is one of the toughest ones to recover from and the least certain in terms of the outcome. So however, you can forget about that now because actually this is what has actually happened here. So those were the predictions, but through the efforts of yourselves and everybody else in the city and the steps that have been taken to date, this is actually where we find ourselves. So we're actually getting significant capital reinvestment and new investment interest. So the actual statistics say 17,000 new business registrations here. Now, we didn't think that was quite right, and so you can edit out the noise in that, because some of that's about kind of just setting up partnerships around different financial institutions and that sort of thing. But there's about 11,000 of those are actual real new companies doing business here in Canterbury. And there's also 1,000 businesses who have migrated in. Now, that's not they're transfers from the rest of New Zealand, so not a brilliant story for New Zealand Inc, but certainly good for Canterbury. We're getting growth figures that you would expect to perhaps only see in China and places like that at the moment. And probably the most kind of encouraging thing is some of those really early issues that may well have led to some of those other trajectories have either been resolved or well understood or able to be managed, including things like the cost. Whoops. So new businesses are opening up, and I knew that someone had asked, so yes, some are closing and some are moving, but there's a really high rate of new businesses that are doing well. And some are arriving and some are leaving, but again, the trajectory is on that upward swing. Labour market, that was again one of those indicators. How were we doing? Well, actually, we've got really low unemployment, lower than the rest of New Zealand by quite a long way. In fact, lower than anywhere, especially if we say Canterbury, not Christchurch, because actually the lowest place in New Zealand is Ashburton, or last time I looked, it's kind of approaching zero. We're getting 25 workers per day, so we're keeping unemployment low even though workers are pouring in the door. So there's new jobs being generated and people going into them. Probably one of the really encouraging things about that as well is that a really high proportion and a growing proportion of that is high-skilled labour, and so therefore high-paid, so giving people that opportunity around good lives. And then the international migration, here's the kind of average around the month at the moment. We're very lucky that the immigration settings in New Zealand are actually very flexible, and so there was no need to change legislation. We just need to use the dials we've got to be able to change who can get in and out actually on a weekly and monthly basis to make sure that people can get access to highly skilled staff without locals missing out. So what's the cost of the rebuild and where's all that coming from? So the number I'm allowed to use publicly, which is the one that kind of everyone can agree on and has some good data under it, is 40 billion. It's likely to go north, but I'll explain why I'm not worried about that at the moment. But you can see that this is very much residentially driven recovery, and that's where an awful lot of the work needs to be done and delivered. And you saw Peter's graph about that's the work that's actually started underway and pumping out there. And the rest here, so we've got commercial, and of course part of the role is for us to try and help you get the barriers out of the way so that slice of the pie gets bigger, and that people want far more investment than might have first been thought. Infrastructure, which is going on flat out, and the government up here in community assets, and government of course being local and central. So this is why the number and whether it goes up a bit isn't a bad story for Canterbury. This is where the money's coming from. And so sure, you can see that between the government and you guys, the private investment, we've got this chunk here, but actually the vast majority, 75% collectively, is coming out of insurance. And that number growing tends to be coming from actually, we've now looked down every, you know, more pipes and under more houses and what have you. And I don't know about you, but I used a case study of my one house, which started off, I think, at about 6,000, and actually by the time all the assessments were done, is sort of approaching 80,000 to fix it. You multiply that out a large number of times, and that's the impact you get. Now this, have a look at this graph with a wee bit of caution, but it was so fascinating to me, I thought you would enjoy it as well. But this is, it is incomplete data, so it underrepresents because not all of the players have their data in here, but it is the latest data out from the Reserve Bank and EQC, and is right as of June. But this just shows you the cumulative amount of money that's being paid out and pushed out into the community and available for fueling those booms that we're talking about. Now this is not a graph in the usual sense, and it doesn't, so don't worry too much about the scale. But this is just a way of trying to explain what some of the challenges are and what some of the things that Warwick in particular needs to grapple with, and with advice for our team. And that is, To get that right trajectory, if you think back to that first drawing, get us actually up there into the purple, we've got to get it right in here. There's no two ways that straight after those things, it's too hard for the private sector to put their investment in. The uncertainties and the risks are too high. And so indeed, you have to get the public sector doing this huge spend decisively, early, and without blinking. And I'll have to say that that's what our government does. It committed to a whole lot of things before they even knew the exact cost of those. to allow, to bring in that certainty and confidence and lower the risk for the next wave of investment from the private investment. Now, what Peter's talking about is actually making sure we're on top of getting in here and getting that right, because one of the possibilities, you saw those charts from Peter about the size of the public sector potential investment. If that's pulled on full noise, we can crowd the private sector out and make it too difficult for that to land. So whilst you love us to give you dates and timelines and things, we actually have to keep our fingers on some of those dials to actually get the conditions right for you to do what you need to do as well. One of the other things is that probably I should have drawn that line in here for the public investment, because one of the things is that for every bit of investment that the government does, actually we need about $6 to $8 from the private sector to really get that amazing outcome that we want at the end. So private sector is the biggest investor of all in order to get the outcomes that we would all want. So the government's role, what the government's been busy doing, a lot of it via CERA but also through lots of other agencies, is around providing that clarity and certainty through the design, whether it be the blueprint design or community wellbeing programs, getting that participation by taking the first mover risk, and that includes not just building stuff but like putting all of our employees into town, restoring the infrastructure and that civic amenity, trying to make sure that the ease of doing business is there. So, you know, some of you will have benefited by some of the changes in tax compliance rates and things like that, the immigration rules, to try and make it as easy as possible for you. Creating that really good quality public realm. Got a bit of flack about going early with the Avon River and the money that we're spending there, but our assumption was if we got that public realm really high quality, it would help people have the confidence to put development around it. And indeed, if you look at the earliest developments, they are threaded around the river. And certainly having that whole of government investor support and trying to get barriers out of the way and assist people. So how's it going? If I look at those trajectories, how do we think it's going? I thought it would be useful just to share with you, I guess, a few indicators and tasters about what that's looking like. Warwick talked to you a little bit about the health precinct, and I'd have to say that was one, not all of our assumptions stacked up, because we the Avon River one did. This one we actually thought would be on a bit more of a back burner and would take longer, and it would take a while for the private sector to want to see that. But lo and behold, they got it absolutely and very early. So our kind of what we thought was very audacious goals was around getting 2,000 extra employees in there. So that's over and above, there are about 6,000 that are employed at the hospital already, and about 2,000 academics. So that's researchers, lecturers and students. Now, before, we haven't finished even sort of designing how all that'll be or taken it out to the market, but already we've had this sort of 60% of the FTE interest and this sort of square meterage of interest before it's even gone out there. So that one's pumping. All of the EOIs and RFPs that have gone out, whether it's been by us or with others, have got really high quality fields coming in, competing to do this work, wanting to be part of it. And that they've all been mixtures of local, national and international players. The retail precinct Warwick's talked about, the river I've talked about. Probably the other thing to let you know is just one of the things we see, and you don't have that window, is just the number of people banging on our door each day looking for the opportunity to come in. And they're from right across the spectrum, from people who want to kind of bring large sums of money to invest here, people who want to be developers, through to businesses, or someone who just wants to be able to get into the distribution chain because they've got the very best LED lights in the world, according to them. So it's huge variety, but it's been constant and steady and heavy from the beginning. So the central city is open. Hotels is one that lots of people were worried about. It's been interesting the impact that the Council's decision around the town hall that was holding up some of this, and it's interesting just how quickly that's allowed some people to crystallise their ideas, because it made a difference to where was the best positions and indeed what positions were even available. I know people tell me they still have trouble finding a table in a restaurant, but look, this is the number that I've got themselves up and running, 25% of the CBD, and there's about 150 or more on their way. So you've still got plenty of opportunity to go to a new one every week. So these are just some indicators of what's happening in that buzz building and that vitality coming back into the city. Warwick talked about the residential demonstrator and about the goals around residential, because certainly this is what's needed to support the businesses and to get that vitality and that 24-hour life. This is a current piece of work with a team working hard on this, because we're conscious this has been a goal for the city for a long time. So actually something different needs to happen for it to become a reality. So this would be an area that we would really welcome people's input and ideas and suggestions and engagement with us. The plan is to have a chapter to go into the recovery plan on how this is to be achieved and what the goals are and how that will happen in the first quarter of next year. So now's the time to feed into that. So how can we assist? Look, as Murray talked about, we've got a team of people who will help in terms around investment, construction, those things. The sooner you can talk to us about what the issues are, any barriers you're hitting, let us know what you need, the better chance we can help you. We've got a new guy on, Alistair Pearson, if you haven't met him, who's doing this construction coordination. Alistair's trying to make sure that you get the utilities and everything's lined up and happening so that you're not hitting those barriers. He's getting some really great success, and so are the parties that are working together. So, for example, getting the utilities working together around trenching and what gets laid down a hole in the road. So getting all the utilities lined up, and they're getting like 30% plus savings just by that collaboration and getting that done, and the developers are getting all of their services when they need them. We've also got investment facilitators, business attraction, and some tenancy strategy support, and so that's going on. So if you haven't been working with my team before and you don't know how to get hold of us, make sure you take a business card, and we're only too happy to help. We can't fix everything, but we'll do our darndest. One of the latest things we're doing is, and the comms team setting this all up, is to actually have an interactive mapping tool online to help you get access to information. But if you go online at the moment, you'll see something that looks a bit like that. So I don't want you to go on that and think, well, that's got nothing much I need to know, I'm not going back there. Because this is the beginning, and we're really dependent on you helping us and giving us information. But when you click on one of these dots, which should be everywhere in every section over time, is it will tell you who owns it, what's happening there, what the opportunities are, if there are tenancies available, if there are investment opportunities available, whatever else, plus all of the mapping around facilities and roadworks and things like that. So we would love you to share your information so that we can make this a really useful tool, and we'd love to hear from you about what other information is useful, either on this sort of thing or anything else as well. We've already had the suggestion this week that we must have a proper 3D model of the city that gets built up over time that people can come and interact in. So now's the time for action, and I hope that's helped, and I'm very happy to answer any questions or defer them all to Warwick.